something really up front. I don't want to be deceptive in any way. I want to tell you really what the goals I have for this morning's message, and really it's the same goal every time God allows me to bring His message, whether it's here or whether it's somebody else. The message is what I want you to really begin to know who this Jesus guy is. I really want you to begin to see if Jesus is who He says He is. And not only if we believe Jesus is who He says He is, but why we should care about who He says He is and what He did. And, you know, I don't want to be up front. I just want you to know up front that if you don't know who Jesus Christ is, I've been praying for you. I'm praying by the end of this message that you'll begin to at least see Jesus ministry who He says He is. And if you're already in a relationship with Jesus Christ, if you're starting to develop a relationship with Jesus Christ, I want us to begin to grow together in knowing who Jesus is and how to be one of His committed followers. Not just somebody who says they're a Christian, but a committed disciple of Jesus Christ. And if you're here today and you're not quite sure, you don't believe Jesus is who He says He is or who He said He was, then, I just want to tell you, I'm really, really, really glad that you're here this morning. Because I told you up front, I'm not going to hide the agenda. I want you to get to know Jesus for who He really is and put your trust and your faith in Him and begin to follow Him and begin to live like Him. But I also have a large concern, and not just this church, okay? I'm talking about the church overall. For those who come to church week after week after week and then pretend, or maybe even worse yet, that they truly believe that they're disciples of Jesus Christ. They come to church on Sunday, but they blend back into the world on Monday. And one of the reasons this concerns me so much is because Paul, when he wrote this, and he was writing it to Christians, we know that, when he wrote his first letter to the Christians in Corinth, 1 Corinthians, he said, you were washed, you were sanctified. Now, sanctified just simply means that holy, that you are set apart. You are holy and you are set apart. And Paul writes, you were washed, you were sanctified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. See, if we're truly a disciple, if we're truly a committed follower of Jesus, then we've been made holy and we have been set apart, and we should stand out on Monday through Saturday, not just on Sundays, right? And in too many churches that I've attended and that I go through, and I have much privilege in my life, I'm able to go to other churches and I'm able to speak. I get to speak at revivals and I get to weddings, and I get to do all these things, and I see people who are fooling themselves. And I'm not their judge. Please understand that. I'm not anybody's judge, but the fruits of their life make me believe, anyway, that they're fooling themselves in their Christianity. And what I think is even worse than that, and I've met people like this, or people who are pretending to be followers of Jesus so they can get something from other people. And I don't know, this church, I've never seen it happen in this church. This church is so great. But I have attended large churches where business people came to church with the single purpose of meeting other people so that they could conduct business. It wasn't their worship God. They were there to increase business. They were pretending to believe in Jesus. And then you have other people who form opinions about Jesus Christ based on what others say because they have no personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So maybe this is just really too general of a statement, and it probably is. But again, I want to remind you, I'm not talking about this church in particular. I love this church. I think the people that come here are magnificent. I think you're great. I've seen tremendous growth here. But I'm talking about the Big C church in particular. I'm talking about the body of Christ in particular. And I think we have three different kinds of people, as a general rule, in the churches. You have those that are curious. And if you're curious this morning, I really thank you for being here, because honestly, that's why we started this church. That's why we started the Odyssey Church. Selbyville did not need another church. I mean, Selbyville, they have a street called Church Street because they have five churches on one street. Shelbyville didn't need another church. What they needed was a different kind of church. They needed a church that wouldn't judge you for what you've done in the past. They needed a church that wouldn't judge you for what you're in the middle of right now. They needed a church where people would love you right where you're at so God could take you to where he wanted you to be at.
Amen.
See, church, they didn't need another church here. There's plenty of churches. The sad fact is, with as many churches as there are in Shelbyville, less than about 10% of the population attend those churches. So, you know, that's why we started the Odyssey, for these people who are trying to figure out who Jesus is and what this Jesus thing is really all about. And then we have, you know, I'm just hoping that we have a bunch of you here. You know, that's why we built this place. And if we don't, we need to start inviting them. There's a lot of churches in this area, but I don't think you're going to find one that is accepting as this church. And because I don't care. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what you're doing. Because I love you. I truly do love you. And I care about where you're going. So first we have the curious, and then we have the committed. And a committed is those that are truly a disciple of Jesus Christ. Those who are convinced who Jesus is, those who are committed to who Jesus is, and those who you can look at their life and you can see the fruits, you can see the good deeds, you can see by their life that they are truly committed disciple of Jesus Christ. It's in every aspect of their lives. And the evidence of that commitment is this new life that they found in Jesus Christ and the good deeds that they do, not so that they can get glory, but because those good deeds that they do point to our Lord Jesus Christ. So we have the curious. And that's great because, you know, if we're honest with ourselves, that's how we all started out. At one point, somebody either said something, we saw something, we heard something, and we began to wonder and question if Jesus really is who he said he was. We were curious. That's how we all started out. No matter where you're at in your relationship with Jesus Christ, no matter how long you've been following, some point in time, something made you curious and you began to be a follower. And we have the committed. And I love the committed. And we have so many people in this church that are committed, and we can see that by the fruits and by what they're doing in their lives, because they're here all throughout the week, not just on Sundays, and we don't announce it, and we don't, you know, we give the glory to God, but there's people that all throughout the week help us clean the church. There's people here that when there's a special event come in, they bring it, they buy the supplies for the children's church. I mean, I could go on and on and on and on again. But the website and all these other things we take care of, well, there's people around here going, there's no way I could do it all by myself. And, you know, committed in other ways too. There's some of you give large financial donations, and we appreciate that. We're in a position right now that we haven't been in a long time, and we're trusting God to take care of it. But rent's due, car broke down, we had to buy propane. Propane was $400. We just had a tremendous amount of bills that came due all of a sudden. And, you know, we rarely mention that, but for those of you that have it, we are asking you to dig a little deep because we really need it right now. But really, you have the curious and you have the committed, but the ones that trouble me the most are those that are convinced of their salvation, but they have no fruit in their life. Sort of like they're pretenders. You have the curious, the committed, and then you have the convinced, and that's the one that's troubling to me. These are the people who say Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. In fact, they are convinced of it. They are convinced that heaven is their goal when they die and that God is going to bless them today. But that knowledge has not moved from their head to their lives. They've missed it by about 12 inches. It's not moved from their head to their heart, so it becomes apparent in their lives. They still act the same way they did before they met Jesus Christ. They're pretending. They're the one, as sad as it is, they're the ones, and we're all truly hypocrites to some degree, but those that are convinced of their salvation but with no fruits are the ones that the world looks at and said, that's why I don't go to church. Because those people are just hypocrites. Now again, I'm a hypocrite. I have to admit that. I don't always live like I would like to live. I mean, standing up here and telling you absolute truth and absolute how way to live is absolutely, absolutely easier to do than walk off this stage and live it out.
Amen.
I'm not where I want to be, but I thank God I ain't where I used to be.
Amen.
You know what? We should look back on our lives and say, are we moving in the direction of Jesus Christ? Or am I stagnant, or am I actually going backwards? Now, we know that life sometimes has its ups and downs. You don't have to feel guilty if you look back and say, well, I'm not as close as I used to be. Actually, it's a good thing, because then you realize you need to start moving forward. But if you just don't care, that's something different entirely. So today I'm hoping, and my prayers have been, and I do pray for these services, and I know that it's not in me, but I've been praying that by God's Holy Spirit, because without Him, as we're going to see in just a few minutes, it's not possible. But my prayer has been, if you're curious, or you're a pretender, or you've convinced yourself that you're something more than you are, that today you will make a decision to be a true, committed follower of Jesus Christ. Committed to being a disciple of Jesus Christ. Committed to being a viable part of the body of Christ. And, it may sound selfish, but being committed to the Odyssey Church as well. Because we need you. Let's just, we love you, and we need you. What a great relationship that is. And you may not know this. We say it so often, I think it's, we inoculate ourselves to it. We say it. It's like the pictures you put on the refrigerator of your kids. You see them when you first put them up, and after a while, it just becomes routine, and you don't see them anymore. We say it so often, but I really hope you believe this, is that God loves you more than you can ever imagine. That He created you for a purpose. He created you to do good works for His glory. So I'm just going to pause before we get started today, and I just want to remind you of a couple of things. You know, the first thing is, do you know that God loves you? I mean, do you really, really know that? So often we say yes, but we don't take time to think about it. When you realize that a God who created everything in the universe, He created this earth, He created you and knew you before you were even in your mother's womb, that He didn't create you just because He was bored and didn't have anything to do. He created you because He loves you. And because He loves you, the second thing is He has a plan. Yes. He has a purpose for your life. And when you really, really begin to understand, it changes everything. I mean, if we would just begin to think about this, meditate about it, and understand, you would see how amazing this is, that God wants to be in a relationship with you. And it took me a long time, because I know God knows everything about me. And God knows everything about you. And I don't know about you, but I'm a mess. And before I surrendered my life to Jesus Christ, I was a real mess, because I was living for my own desires. I was living for this world. I was living for everything. And I profess, and I don't speak just to speak words, because they have Jesus Christ in our life.
Amen.
Amen.
And I see it all the time. In fact, I believe if I was to put it on a scale and look at the ratio, there are more happy people that are poor than there are those that are rich, because rich people rely on their money and poor people can't rely on anything but God. And when they rely on God, they have an inner peace and an inner joy that the world cannot buy.
Amen.
God wants you to experience a great life, not just in this world, but the next world as well. So if there's the first thing I want you to know. If you're curious, you know, all that sounds like sort of really bad news, but if you're curious, it might even sound condemning. You know, I don't mean it to. Because if you're curious, or you're committed, or you're convinced, I'm just going to give you some comforting news. It's not your fault. And as a way of illustrating that, I got my good friend Acapello up here on stage. Now, Acapello is a starving gospel singer. If you weren't here Thursday night when we had Anchorman here, he was on stage with them. And if you didn't see the Anchorman, they're not starving. Acapella may be starving, but the Anchorman eats well. I'm just telling you that, okay? But Acapella says, "Hi, everybody. Glad you're all here this morning. I just want to get that out of the way." But if you have your Bibles this morning, turn them to the book of Ephesians chapter 2. And we're just going to be looking at the first 10 verses. That's the book of Ephesians chapter 2, sort of a small book. So, you know, take your time trying to find it. And I'm going to invite you to take notes this morning. Grab a pen out of the back of the chair in front of you and write down whatever it is that you think that is important to you and your personal faith journey. You can do it, but I don't know if it's a good idea. You can write down what you think somebody in your life needs and then let's sort of like lay it on the table and hope they read it. But that doesn't always work in my house, I can just tell you that. But I want to start out. Now, how many of you would be surprised as if I'm up here and I'm speaking and all of a sudden Acapella here, he just gets up and starts giving the message. Says, "Bob, sit down." He just gets alive and he just says, "Sit down." I don't know about you, but I would. And if he did that, here's one thing I learned. I don't have to run fast. I just have to run faster than the slowest person here. I'm making a beeline for the door. But it's probably not going to happen. Because a skeleton, what's a skeleton represent? It represents a dead person, right? And I think we all can agree that Acapella here is hopeless, he's helpless, he's lifeless, and there's nothing he can do to give himself life, is it?
Right, amen.
If you go to a funeral, and many of you have, and if you've recently lost somebody, please forgive me for this. But if you go to a funeral, and as you're looking over your deceased friend or whoever it is, and they got up and raised up and said, "Hi, how you doing?" Would it set you back a little bit?
I think quite a bit.
No. Yeah. It's impossible for dead people to do anything because they're D-E-A-D. They are dead. They're helpless and they're hopeless in their life. And there's nothing in and of themselves that they can do to give themselves life, is there? They're dead. That's how we are without Jesus Christ. We are spiritually dead. Look at how the Apostle Paul begins in chapter 2, verse 1. "Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins." Now, that doesn't mean we're physically dead. It means we're spiritually dead. We're like zombies. We're death walkers. We're dead and we don't even know it. If you have not made Jesus Christ both your Lord and your Savior, according to the Apostle Paul, you are hopeless and helpless and lifeless. You are spiritually dead. You are a death walker. You don't have issues. You don't have some things that you're trying to work through. You're not wrestling with a few things. You haven't made a couple of mistakes. You're spiritually dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. Norman Geisler, an author of a book of, it's called Chosen But Free, he writes this. He writes, "Like a drowning person." In other words, what he's talking about is a person who's never made Jesus Christ their Lord and Savior. They're still dead in their spiritual walk, their spiritual life. "Like a drowning person, a fallen person, can reach out and accept the lifeline." You know what he's saying? Somebody throws them a life preserver, they can reach out and grab it, but they can't make it to safety on their own. But I don't think that's what Paul is saying. R.C. Sproul, and I don't know if you know him, R.C. Sproul is a wonderful teacher. He has a podcast that he claims that is somewhere between a Bible study and the school of theology. It's a little deeper than a Bible study, but it's not quite a doctorate level theology. He He's also not only a doctor of theology, he's a professor, he's a pastor, he's the president of Ligonier Ministries, among many other things. But what he's saying is, it's a whole lot worse than just being a drowning person that somebody needs to throw a life preserver to. He says, it's more like we're not drowning, but we're actually a corpse at the bottom of the sea. He said, God doesn't throw a life preserver to a drowning person. He goes to the bottom of the sea and pulls up a corpse from the bottom of the sea, takes it to the bank, breathes into it, and the breath of life, and makes him alive. It's not that you're drowning and you need a life preserver. It's that you're a corpse at the bottom of the sea. You're dead. And if this is true, and according to the writings of Paul, I believe it is, do you think there's anything that I can do to get acapello in my own power to become alive? You know, can I beat him over the head with the Bible and make him come alive? Can I make him, you know, guilt him? Or can I criticize him? Can I condemn him to make him come alive?
Yep.
But isn't that what we do with Jesus, you know, as Christians sometimes? Why won't you come to church? I'm dead. Why won't you quit smoking and cussing and drinking? I'm dead. If you don't accept Christ, you're going to go to hell. I'm already dead. There's nothing we can do to get a dead person alive. That is up to God. But that doesn't leave us without responsibility. We need to love people enough to tell them about Jesus. But let me tell you something, folks. A sermon is better lived than preached. We have to show them by loving them. So yes, certainly we need to tell people about Jesus. We need to tell people that God loves them. But we also have to leave the results up to God. And this has been a struggle with me personally. Okay, I have a 29-year-old daughter who does not only not walk with God, but is hostile towards God. Mm. And believe that she purposefully antagonizes me through social media and conversations because of my faith in God. But I do not blame her. She is dead. She is spiritually dead, and it took me a long time not to blame her. It took me to research and study God's Word and actually preach a message that I have a responsibility to water and plant the seeds of Jesus Christ to her. But it is not my responsibility to bring the harvest. I need to leave that up to God.
Amen.
So we need to tell God, but we have to leave the results up to them. And we can't blame them. And we can't guilt them into becoming alive, nor should we. I mean, if you're a Christian, then before you were alive in Christ, you were dead. And here's the reason why. You used to live in sin. Right?
Amen.
I mean, I don't know about you, but I not just lived in sin, I lived for sin. And I said this last week, but it was so important to me when I heard this. I lived for sin because it brought temporary happiness. But one thing sin never did in my life was bring me joy. In fact, it did the opposite. In my temporary situation of committing the sin, I might have had some pleasure. But the guilt and the depression and everything else that went along with it because of God's conviction, my consciousness, everything else, it was never worth it. I didn't understand it at the time, but I do today. You used to live in sin, so we can't condemn others who are living in sin because that was us. Just like the rest of the world, we used to live in sin. We were obeying the devil, the commander of the powers of the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. If you're a committed Christian. You can't, or at least you shouldn't, be too hard on people who don't believe, because you were once dead in your sin, just like they are, just like the rest of the world. And here's the thing. We're not just dead because of the many sins we've committed. It goes much, much deeper than that. We're dead because of our sinful nature. Psalm 52, King David, a man who God himself says is a man after my own heart. In Psalm 52, David writes, "For I was born a sinner. Yes, from the very moment my mother conceived me." See, we're like a stillborn child. We're dead the moment we're conceived in the womb. And nobody can blame a stillborn child for being stillborn. Just like you can't convince a dead body to come to life. You can't do anything to bring spiritual life on yourself. And you shouldn't condemn someone who's dead in their sin. First of all, it's not your job, it's God's job. I know some of you may think this, but you are not God. Second of all, it doesn't glorify God, and you were created to glorify God. And the third thing is, you shouldn't condemn them because you too were once dead in your sins. Verse 3, all of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and the inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. All of us, me, you, all of us, used to live that way. And all of us deserve God's wrath. It's in our DNA. It's in my nature. It's in your nature. It's our sinful nature. Now, here's where theology is different, but this is what I believe. Because we are dead, do we have no responsibilities? You can't put responsibility on a dead person, right? I don't believe because we're dead, we have no responsibilities. See, here's the thing. We think, well, once I accept Christ, I'm alive, and that's true to some degree. But if God has woken you up to one single fact, if God has woken you up to the fact that you are a sinner, then I believe He has breathed life into your hopeless and helpless spiritual body. And you have a responsibility to respond to His life. If you were drowned, and you become unconscious, and you're not breathing, and somebody on the shore begins to give you mouth-to-mouth, and you're resuscitated, you need to start breathing again on your own. If God has breathed life into you, even if it's just enough life to open your eyes to the fact that you're a sinner, then you have life now. And you have a responsibility to accept that gift and begin to breathe on your own. So the first thing God does is God gives you light to see the condition you're in. And if you see the condition you're in, you have a responsibility. God gives you, He awakens you, He gives you light so you can see the condition you're in. You are helpless and you are hopeless and you are spiritually dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. And you cannot save yourself. But if God opens your eyes to the condition you're in, He has breathed some life into you. And you can't say, well, I'm a good person, so God has to let me into His heaven. You can't say, well, I was baptized as a child, so God has to let me into His heaven. You can't say, well, I'm better than so-and-so. In fact, that guy over there who is convinced he's going to heaven, who the fruits of his life say he's going to heaven, occasionally he messes up real bad, and I'm even better than him, so I must get to go to heaven because I'm a good person. Well, if you think you're a good person, you know, I want to take the good person test. And I want you to take it with me. I want to see if you qualify to be a good person. Now, I don't want you to answer these questions out loud, but be honest and think about it. You don't have to answer them out loud. Because the people know, you already know the answers. Why do that to yourself, you know? First question on the am I a good person test. Have you ever told a lie? Even a small white lie. Does this dress make my look bad? Now be careful with that one, right? Abraham Lincoln. Have you ever stolen something? Even as a kid. Or maybe taken a postage stamp from work. Nobody will notice it. They don't care. Taking a pen or a pencil. I got a whole stack of them in there, I have to be honest with you. Maybe something from a brother or a parent or a friend. Have you ever looked at somebody with lust? You got any from? Have you ever really hated a person, even for a single moment? You know, maybe somebody did evil to you. Maybe somebody hurt one of your kids. Maybe somebody cost you a relationship or cost you a job. Have you ever looked at what somebody else had and said, you know, I'd like to have that, and I can't, but it almost makes me drool. If you answered yes to those questions, you just admitted that you're a liar, a thief, an adulterer, a murderer, and you're covetous. You just admitted to breaking 5 of the 10 commandments, and we haven't even got started yet. According to God's standard of perfection, you're not a good person, and you deserve His anger and His wrath. Now, I have to admit to you, that sounds sort of condemning. It sounds like bad news, but you know it can't be. It has to be good news to be the gospel, because gospel means good news. I'm going to confess something to you right now. I like big butts. I like big butts, and I can't not. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins, but God, these are the two words at the heart of God's message to His creation. These are the words that are at the heart of the gospel. But God, over and over and over again in our Bibles, in these holy scriptures, these ancient scriptures, but God, and these are big buts. And I like these big buts, and I cannot lie. Chapter 50, verse 20. You meant evil against me, but God meant it for good in order to save many people. Psalm 49, 14 and 15. Their beauty shall be consumed in the grave, but God will redeem my soul from the power of the grave. Psalm 73, verse 26. My flesh and my heart fail, but God is my strength, but my heart and my portion forever. Romans chapter 5, verse 7 and 8. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ has not seen nor ear heard the things which God has prepared for those who love Him. But God has revealed them to us through His Spirit. But God, who is so rich in mercy, and He loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved.
Amen.
But God. So amazing, as I was trying to put this message together, because this was not the message I intended to speak today. The verses were, the message is not. And as I was sitting there going over these verses, I'm thinking, why does God raise us from being dead. And he says right here, I raise you from being dead just as I raised Christ from being dead. Why would God raise us from the dead just like his own son was raised from the dead? And that God sort of spoke to my heart. And it was amazing. He said, because I love you as much as I love my son. Isn't that amazing? God loves you as much as he loves his very own son. And this is so important. God is so rich in his mercy because of his great love for us that even though we have hurt him and we have denied him and we have been disobedient to him, and even though we know and he knows about our many sins, God loves us as much as his own son. So he opens our eyes. He breathes life into us so we can see the condition we are in. We were dead. But God, we were rebels against his kingdom, but God. We were slaves to Satan in this world, but God. We were deserving of wrath, but God is so rich in mercy and he loves us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life. We were walking with the sinners, but God. And now we walk with Jesus Christ. We were deserving of anger and wrath, but God. And we get grace. We were dead, but God. And we are made alive. We were under Satan's feet, but God. We are raised up and seated with Jesus. For he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realm because we are united with Christ Jesus. When did God make us alive? When we were dead. When did God make us alive and show us the condition we were in? When we were dead in our sin. And this is so amazing to me. God knows our sinful hearts so well. This grace, this mercy, this being raised from the dead is a gift. Because he knew if we had to earn it, we'd brag about it. Mm-hmm. If we had to do something, if God made a set of rules and we earned our way into heaven, we would boast about it. What a loving God we serve. When he opens our eyes to the condition we're in, he offers this gift of salvation, and he offers it freely, and all we have to do is accept the gift so that no one can boast that they earned their way back. And you know, really, if we're honest with each other, I think that's really part of the problem. You know, somebody comes to you and offers you a gift of great wealth, and you know you don't deserve it, it is very hard to accept. I have a hard time accepting small gifts. You know, I don't feel that I'm worthy. I don't feel like I'm deserving. And I just give an example. I was lunch with a guy yesterday. He pulled out his wallet. Said, here's $100 for what you did for me last week. I said, brother, I did that because I love you, not for the money. And he put the $100 back in his wallet. I'm like, shouldn't have said that. But the fact is, I have a hard time taking gifts, and that's part of the problem of salvation. It's free, and it's a gift, and grace is hard to accept. Grace is hard to believe. Grace is hard to receive. You know, think about it this way. If a telemarketer were to call you on the phone and say, listen, I'm not trying to sell you anything at all. I just want you to go to Hawaii on our dime. So, expense-paid free trip. We don't want you to buy anything. We just, you know, we're going to pay your airfare. We're going to pay your boat. We're going to give you spending money. You're going to go to Hawaii. We're even going to call your boss, and there's going to be somebody to take your place there. It's all free. It's all for you. All you have to do is say yes. And don't we go into spy mode? Mm-hmm. We're trying to figure out what's the catch.
Yeah.
You know, what's going on here? Because nothing is free. That's what we've been taught. But grace is the only gift that is not only free, but will last into all of eternity. And all you have to do is accept it. And when you get a gift from somebody, somebody loves you and they give you a gift, you don't go, how much do I owe you? The appropriate response is thanks. The appropriate response is praise. But so often, even as Christians, even after we realize this, even after we read it, even after we heard it, after everything, we get this free gift of salvation, and then all of a sudden we still feel obligated to try and earn our way and work our way into heaven, don't we? God gives us this gift, and we say, okay, God, now that I've got it, let me see what I can do to earn it. God said, you're missing a point. But he doesn't give us this gift for no reason at all. He gives this gift to us for a purpose. And Paul tells us what that purpose is. He said, I give you this gift freely so God can point us in all future ages as examples of the incredible well of his grace and his kindness towards us, as shown in all he has done for us who are united with Jesus Christ. He said, I'm giving it to you freely, but I'm giving it to you for a purpose, because I want your life to point as an example of what I have to offer. I give it to you so that you can live in such a way that your life will be an example to future ages of my incredible wealth of grace and my kindness towards you. See, so often, and I know I preached it, I know most preachers pass, and as I begin to read the scriptures, the way I even talk and interpret is beginning to change, because salvation isn't for us. Salvation is for God. You know, when a person is resurrected out of their sin, when somebody is transformed from death unto life, God is putting his boundless grace, he's putting his endless mercy, he's putting his everlasting love on display for all to see. God does offer. God offers this incredible gift of salvation with a single purpose in mind. To display, to point to the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness to us. So that all can see us as an example of Jesus Christ. And this gift, as much as we cherish it, as much as we need it, as much as we enjoy it, is given to us to glorify God for all that he has done for us. And it's a gift that is received by faith. God saved you by his grace when you believe. By simple faith. All you have to do is believe. And you can't take credit for it. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done. So no one can boast about it. You know, if we're really honest with ourselves, acapella here is life. It's our life. He represents a dead person. We're dead or we were dead. We were either dead or we were dead. And you aren't alive because you came to an altar at the end of the service. You aren't alive because you raised your hand at a service when there was an altar call. You're not alive because you said some kind of prayer. You're made alive by God's grace, and by his mercy, and by his power.
Yes.
You and I were dead, and only God could bring us back to life. Because he loves you. Because he loves me. Just like he loves you. Just as much as he loves his very own son. Sometimes we look at our lives and we look at our circumstances and we say, it sure doesn't look like it. Sure doesn't feel like that God loves me. I'm not even sure if God cares about me. Look what I'm going through. But I'm going to tell you something, folks. The empty tomb is all the proof you need that God not only loves you, but he cares for you. Why else would he send his son into this world and let him die an awful death on a cross and then raise him from the dead in a spectacular way? See, we're not defined by our circumstances. We're defined by our Savior who bought us, who redeemed us with his very own blood and brought us from death unto life. We were helpless, we were hopeless, we were lifeless. See, God moves when the miracle will be the greatest. God moves when the miracle will be the greatest so that He can get the glory and we can't. He moves when the miracle is going to be the greatest. When you were dead, He made you alive so that you don't get to take credit for it. But you get the privilege of giving Him credit. We're helpless, hopeless, lifeless. So much so that our eternal salvation comes from another place. It doesn't come from us. We're dead in our sins. But God. We're not saved from God's wrath by what we've done or what we do, but by what Christ has done. And what Christ has done in us and through us and for us. Martin Luther is known as the great reformist. He changed the entire way the church teaches in what's known as the Great Reformation. Martin Luther says, God creates faith in the human heart the same way He created the world. He found nothing and made it into something. See, but I don't think that leaves us without responsibility. God breathes life into our hopeless and our lifeless, our helpless spiritual bodies. He opens our eyes to the condition we're in, and we see this gift of salvation. We see that we're sinners. We see we have no hope of saving ourselves. And it's all done by grace, but we have to accept the gift of salvation. We have to reach out our arms and accept it. And when we do, God alone is glorified. You can't take credit for it. You can't buy it. You can't earn it. You can't have somebody give it to you. You have to simply accept it. So it points, and your life points, to the riches and the mercies of God's grace and God's love. And that God can use you as an example to all the world of His love and His kindness. And when it does, God alone is the one who gets the glory. You know. I know. God knows. We are a mess. We are messed up people. God says you're stiff-necked. You want to go your way. I want you to go my way. We give this appearance on the life on the outside, but in the inside we're dead. We're death walkers. We're zombies. If we don't have Jesus Christ living inside us. We live in sin like the rest of the world. Obeying Satan, the commander of the unseen world. We follow the passionate desires and the inclinations of our own sinful nature. And we are deserving of God's anger and God's wrath. In other words, we're just a plain mess. But God specializes in people who are messes.
Amen.
Aren't you glad of that?
Amen.
God takes us from the lowest of the low to the highest of the high. God takes our messes and turns them into masterpieces. God takes our messes and He begins to create a masterpiece because we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do good things which He planned for us to do. Long ago. See, it's not just something that came to His forefront today. I came to salvation. Now God's got to make a plan for my life. He had a plan for your life before He ever created you in your mother's womb.
Amen.
He had a plan for you because you're His masterpiece, and a plan was made up for you personally long ago. And whatever plan God has for your life is unique and for you, and nobody else can do it but you. God takes your mess and makes it a masterpiece. Take the mess of your life and you become God's masterpiece. We're created for a purpose. We're created to point others to God's glory. And we do this by doing the good things God planned us to do long ago. God gives us this gift of new life, and he gives it to us freely, and we accept his offer of salvation by his grace and by our faith, and we cross over from death unto life. And we aren't saved by the good things we do, but the good things we do are the evidence and the result of our salvation. Doing good things is the fruit of our salvation, not the cause of it. We are dead in our sins, and then we become alive in Christ, and doing good things is the outcome of that. Only through Jesus Christ can we become good and righteous and be able to stand before a holy God. Only by God's grace can we be saved. In one of the commentaries I read, it said something like this: a Christian isn't a Christian unless the direction of his or her life is in doing good things for the glory of God. A Christian isn't a Christian unless the direction, not occasion, but the direction of his or her life is doing good things for the glory of God.
Amen.
Pay attention to this. If you don't get anything else out of the message, get this. God loves you personally.
Amen. Yes.
God loves you personally. He loves you, and he offers you your mercy. And his mercy, simply explained, is by not getting what you do deserve. You deserve wrath, but he seats you in the heavenly realms. Because we are united with Jesus Christ. God loves you so much that he offers his grace. And grace is simply getting what you don't deserve. You don't deserve his offer of salvation. You've been disobedient. You've been following your sinful nature. You've had the inclination and desires of this world. But God says, I love you so much. I'm going to give you grace. I'm going to give you what you don't deserve. I'm going to give you eternal life. If you will just accept this gift of grace through my Son, Jesus Christ, I'm going to give it to you anyway. By nature, we're all sinful. We're all hostile towards God, just like dog. That's our nature. So if you're here this morning and you've been among the curious, you've been curious as to who Jesus is and what he can do for you, I want you to know, I've been praying for you. I really have been praying for you. I've been praying that God will reach you down and he would take you from the bottom of the sea and then he would drag you to the shoreline and that he would breathe life into your spiritual life. And I've been praying God would open your eyes to the condition that you're in. I've been praying that God will let you realize that you cannot save yourself. You're helpless and you're hopeless and you're lifeless. And you're dead because of your disobedience towards God and your many sins. I prayed you may know the condition you're in and accept God's offer of salvation and life by simple faith so your life can point others. So God can use your life to point others as an example of his incredible grace. That today may be the day of your salvation. That you realize that you were dead. But God, so rich in his mercy, but God who loves you so much that even though you are dead because of your sins, God gives you life. But God who will take your mess and create a masterpiece so you can do good things as he planned for you to do long ago. And if you're here this year, life, you realize that your life is not pointing others to God's incredible wealth of his grace and kindness, and if your life isn't glorifying God, I've been praying for you as well this week. Praying that God would give you the breath of life this morning. That if you claim to be a Christian, but your life produces no fruit for the kingdom of God, if you don't have any good deeds in accordance with God's word, that God will allow you to see the condition that you're in. That you would stop playing church and that you would stop pretending, that you would see that you live in sin just like the rest of the world. That God would give you life through Jesus Christ and that he would open your eyes to see that you're following your passionate desires, and you're following the inclinations of your sinful nature, and that you would realize that you are still subject to God's anger and God's wrath. And if you're here this morning, and I know many of you fall into this category, if you're in here this morning and you are a committed follower of Jesus Christ, and you're no longer curious and you're no longer a convinced pretender, but you are committed to following Jesus Christ, and the proof of that is the evidence of the fruit in your life, the evidence of your good deeds, the good things you do, which point others to God and His glory, I want you to know that I've been praying for you as well. I've been praying that you understand why this is so important. I've been praying that you'll see that there is a true need to love others and to do good works. I've been praying that you'll realize that there are people all around us, people you love and people I love and people that God loves, that are among the death walkers, that are among the zombies. They are dead and they are disobedient and they have many sins, but they don't even know they're dead. And I'll let you know, we have to make a decision, both personally and as a church. Are we going to go out and reach them? Are we getting involved in our community with Tara and go reach them with our good deeds? Will the good things we do, both individually and as a church, allow God to point us to all future ages as an example of the incredible wealth of His grace and His kindness that He's shown towards us, and all that He has done for us who are united in Christ Jesus, and point others in the direction of God for His glory? And you can't beat them over the head with the Bible, and you can't criticize them, and you can't guilt them into being alive. They're spiritually dead. But what you can be is a light that God uses to point Him in their directions by the good things we do. They are as you once were, and as I once were. And we need to tell them, but even more importantly, we need to show them that God loves them, and that He has a purpose and a plan from long ago for their lives. That God will take their mess, just like He took your mess, just like He took my mess, and He will begin to create a masterpiece. I was dead, but now I'm alive. I used to live in sin, just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commanders of the powers of the unseen world. I used to follow my passionate desires and the inclinations of my sinful nature, and by my very nature, I was subject to God's anger and God's wrath, just like everyone else. But God, who is so rich in mercy, but God, who loved me so much that even though I was dead because of my many sins, but God gave me life. But God took my mess and began to create a masterpiece. I was dead, but God created me anew in Christ Jesus so I can do the good things that He planned for me long ago. I was dead, but God, now I'm alive.
Amen.
I ask you to stand with me as Rob and Tara come back up on stage to lead us one of the greatest hymns ever written. Amazing Grace.